This is Rogers TV.
Welcome to Uxbridge Scugog Life. I'm your host, Jackie Hermans. So the countdown is on. Christmas is around the corner if you celebrate Christmas. Maybe you celebrate Hanukkah. Do you feel prepared? Are you ready? And I hope that's not stressing you out, because I'm not saying that to stress you out, because if you're not ready, it's okay. You will get her done, just like you always do. It all works out in the end. You know, this is the first year that I actually had my Christmas tree up early. I have presents wrapped under the tree. Now, mind you, I didn't wrap those presents. One of my daughters wrapped those presents, and I'm so grateful because I'm feeling more organized. Now, I still have more stuff to do, but that's okay. Everyone, let's take a deep breath together. We're gonna get it done. So this is gonna be a great show. We're talking to Ben Earl, the CEO of Feed the Need. And there's a hunger report that has just been released, and very interesting statistics. And Feed the Need does need your support, so make sure you keep watching about that. Big Red is on the show again from Chuuk. And Chuuk is an amazing Mexican restaurant in Pickering. He is a professional bartender, and we're gonna talk about his favorite holiday drinks. All these drinks are on his Christmas list, and they may end up being on yours. So we'll be right back with more on Uxbridge Scugog Life. Keep on watching.
This program is brought to you by Ignite TV. Now you're in command. Visit Rogers.com for more details.
After a night out with your friends, there's always options for getting home safely. You could call your BFF, your mom or dad, whoever you can count on for a safe ride home. You could call your favorite cab company or 1-888 taxi guy. Or you could use the Arrival Live smartphone app to help you choose your ride. Be it a friend, transit, or taxi, getting home safely is app easy. Now available for iOS and Android devices. Visit arrivealive.org to find out more. Arrive Alive. Drive sober.
Every year, dozens of Canadians are killed or seriously injured because they take risks around railway tracks. Talk to your loved ones about rail safety. Visit stoptracktragedies.ca.
Welcome back to Uxbridge Scugog Life. With me on the show is Ben Earl, who's the CEO of Feed the Need. Welcome, Ben.
Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for coming on the show. So we're going to be talking about the Hunger Report. And I take it, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is the first year that you're actually doing your own Durham Region Report. You're normally involved with the Ontario report. What's the Ontario one called?
Yeah, Feed Ontario does a hunger report every year, and that's released and talks about what's going on with food banks and food security programs across the province. This year, we've actually now done one just specific to Durham to help us understand what's going on in our own community.
Okay, so let's talk about those results. Mm-hmm. So where are we at?
Well, we're seeing an incredible spike in need. I think many people have probably heard this in the news, but the data is backing it up in Durham Region. In the last year, we've seen a 58% increase in the number of visits to food banks across the entire region. We're now seeing about 135,000 visits to food banks specifically, and another 345,000 visits to meal programs. These are emergency meal programs for people who may be homeless or living in shelters. So the need has spiked incredibly across the entire region and across our community, and we're really seeing that demand hit all of our service providers.
So has this been happening because the costs of everything has gone up?
Specifically, when people are listing the reasons for why they're going to food banks, now for the first time, 62% are saying it's the cost of food. That's up about 20% from last year, who are indicating that the cost of food is the main reason they're visiting a food bank. And then other cost of living is the other big reason. Another 20% are indicating costs associated with their housing is the reason why they're not able to make ends meet and are now reaching out to food banks and food programs for support.
Well, when we look at gas prices, mm-hmm. when we look at rent, mm-hmm. that has gone up significantly as well, because they can charge more because mm-hmm. there's such a need for housing as well.
Yeah.
What would you say about the food cost? Do you know the percentage that food costs have gone up?
We know that it's gone up at least the rate of inflation by 8%, but we know that other products, especially a lot of fresh products that are not grown locally, the costs are going up even more because of increased fuel costs to transport them here. Mm-hmm. So we are definitely seeing an impact on food. We also know that as inflation sort of has trickled or slowed down for other products, the cost of food has continued to go up and stayed high. So we know, well, we don't know the exact percentage across all food. We know that the cost of food has gone up exponentially, especially in the last 6 months. And we can all feel this. Even those of us who may not be struggling with food security, yeah. we all know our grocery bills are higher.
Yeah.
I'm feeding a family of four, two young kids. Our grocery bill is definitely higher every month than it has been for many years.
Wow. So what about the supply of mm-hmm. food that the food banks have been receiving from the community? Mm-hmm. Has that changed at all? Has it gone up? Has it gone down?
It has gone up, which is great. We've had amazing support from our community, like we always do. But it hasn't been, we are not able to keep up with the demand. We try to make sure that we're getting out a certain amount to our member agencies. We serve over 60 organizations across Durham. We're not able to get enough food to them to help them meet the needs of everybody on a regular basis. So we are not getting as much food as we need to meet this level of demand. We're still doing well. We still have amazing, generous community in Durham region. The need is just really outpacing the growth of food donations right now.
So what support are you looking for from the community at this time?
Well, this time of year, we're always looking for individuals who want to support us through food drives, running them within your work or your school or wherever you may, or your own community. Definitely, we need food donations. Cash donations and financial donations always help as well. We do have a food purchasing program, which always needs support. But really, we also pick up a lot of food. The vast majority of our food is donated, about 85%. From large grocery retailers and other sources of food in the food system. So financial resources really help us pick up as much food as possible from donated that's free to us to get to people who need it in the community.
Okay. You know, I work for TD Canada Trust mm-hmm. in Port Perry, and we did a Peanut Butter Mountain food drive in all the banks within our area.
Yeah.
And I understand that peanut butter is actually the number one staple.
Peanut butter is always one thing, and we love these types of things where people can sort of make it a bit of a challenge in their community. It helps your community by bringing in donations, but it also brings some spirit to it and makes it fun for people who are trying to give back and do something. Peanut butter is always something we need. If you're looking for other things, definitely canned meat like tuna and other canned meats are always needed. And then the regular staples that you would have in your house, canned vegetables, all the non-perishable things that you might have in your house are things that that we can use. The way I like to tell people is if it's something you would eat and that you have as a staple of your diet in your house, donate it to a food bank because someone else is looking for the same thing.
Oh, nice. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what else did you discover from this report? Mm-hmm. Maybe that was surprising?
I think nothing really surprised us because we hear anecdotally from what's going on. The one thing that is sort of surprising us overall, though, is we are seeing a shift in who is accessing food banks. We're having more people who you may on the surface think don't need to access a food bank, people who are working. In fact, recently Food Banks Canada released information that showed for the first time food bank use is no longer directly tied to people who are unemployed. There are more and more people who are employed fully accessing food programs, and we're seeing that as well in our own network. Mm-hmm. We're seeing people who may have dual incomes in their house. They live in the local suburban communities. They've got what would be considered good jobs. But with changes in interest rates, their mortgage payment maybe changes, and all of a sudden they're paying a lot more every month out for other things. The food budget is often the first thing that gets hit. So they're struggling to make ends meet. So what we need to consider now is that food insecurity is not just hitting, people who maybe are unemployed or have low income. We're also seeing people with middle incomes be impacted as well.
Okay, we're going to talk more about mm-hmm. that. We'll be right back with more on Uxbridge Scugog Life.
Never be a slave. That word it rests on my tongue like rot.
Peter, how does it feel to get paid for your work?
There are rumors freedom's coming for us all.
Freedom, you know that's all I want.
Chloe, careful. Vroomen would rather sell you across the river to America than let you go free.
Then I'll run.
I've run before. Maybe this time for good.
No! No! Just get her into the boat. No! Hey, no!
Chloe! Chloe, no!
Of Chloe Cooley's resistance led to Canada's first legislation limiting slavery. After 200 years, slavery was abolished in Canada in 1834.
Welcome back to Uxbridge Scugog Life. I have Ben Earle, who's the CEO of Feed the Need, and Feed the Need services the Durham region. Mm-hmm. And so we're talking about the hunger report, and yes. You have an interesting statistic as to who's actually using the food bank.
Yeah, we're seeing, in the last year, we've seen 25% of those using the food bank have never used a food bank before. And this is building on last year when we saw about a 30% of those using food banks had never used a food bank before. So increasingly, we're seeing numbers and increase in need driven by people who never had to use these programs, which is interesting.
Now, when I think about the changes that we've experienced during COVID, mm-hmm. the one thing I think about is there's definitely a huge increase in separations and divorces. Mm-hmm. So a lot of single parents out there. What are the stats with single parents using the food bank?
Well, we know that single parents are one of the biggest client groups of all food banks. They have been traditionally of food banks in Durham region in particular. Single parents, especially single mothers, are one of the key client groups for food banks. The other being single individuals who are on their own and with low income. And this is because these are individuals who are expected to run a household, especially a single parent, on a single income in a community that is very much geared towards dual income families. Mm-hmm. So that it really can be a struggle to make ends meet.
Right. So what are, with all the results from the report, what are you doing to help further support the community?
Yeah. Well, the biggest thing we do is food procurement. So we're really redoubling our efforts to get more food into our network. Our target this year is to hit 2.5 million pounds. Of food distributed to our community. That's an increase of almost 100% over last year when we did about 1.5 million. So we're really looking to grow, and we're on pace to hit that target. So it's really about getting more food out through our network and into the community to places that's needed. We've also opened a food bank called the Market Food Bank. We've opened this at our location in Oshawa with plans to move it to somewhere more accessible, but we opened it in July to test the model. It's what we call a grocery store food bank, where individuals, rather than getting a set hamper, they come in and they can shop for themselves. They take a number, they get a basket, and they can fill that basket with products that they need, fresh. We've got a refrigerator and a freezer in there, so they can take fresh food as well as any non-perishables and household items they want. And we've seen exponential growth in this program since it opened in July. We had about 270 visits in July, running one day a week on a Tuesday evening. We're now in November, we were up to 970 visits.
Wow.
So just incredible growth in the demand for our own program, which is reflected across our network.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. And I think the growth within the use of the market, what did you call it, the marketplace?
The marketplace, yeah, the market. Yeah,
the so, market, I yeah. love that. So it could also be from the word getting out, more
yep.
people finding, okay, this is available,
yes.
this is available, this
yeah.
is great. But maybe also changes in circumstances
yeah.
and the inflation.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a bit of both. It's a bit of both. The program being available does drive people, but the fact that they're coming to our program while they may be also accessing other programs shows that the need is greater.
Okay.
Right, so they're coming maybe more often to multiple programs, which is fine. We encourage our network to support people as they need it. We encourage people that if they need to support, to reach out to the places that can support them. So there definitely is that, but you combine that with the changes in circumstances, and that's why we're seeing such exponential growth and unprecedented growth.
Now, last year, let me back up for a second. Mm-hmm. You had a refrigeration vehicle,
yes,
a big van, and you used that, yes, to bring food to different food banks,
yes,
to bring food to your food bank. I understand that it was stolen last year.
Yes.
And that is a huge, how much does one of those vans cost?
Well, when you buy the van and then we retrofit it to be refrigerated, it was about an $80,000 purchase for us.
Wow.
Generously supported by the Durham Community Foundation and Community Foundations Canada. So it was a bit of a big loss when it was taken.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was a loss for us. We're lucky. We got it back. The police did find it about 4 weeks later, and it's needed some it needed some cleaning and repair. But it's back, and it was a brand new van when it was taken, so it's in good repair. It's now back. We're finally going to get it wrapped so that it looks like Feed the Needs vehicle, and then it's going to be out on the road doing its job for us, which is bringing food in and getting food to people who need it.
So what have you been doing since then? Mm-hmm. You know, before getting it back, how are you distributing the food?
It did slow down what we were doing. We had some plans over the summer that we weren't able to take on because we didn't have the van.
Okay.
Things like putting out some mobile services that we could go to neighborhoods with. We've put that off until next summer because we didn't have the vehicle to do it this year, and we had to use the resources we had to meet the growing demand, which was a struggle.
Who has a minivan?
So, exactly.
Okay, we have a truck. We need you.
Exactly. The great thing is we've got wonderful volunteers and a great staff and great people and businesses in the community who all stepped in to help us out. So we got over the gap and over the hump of losing that out. It was a bit disappointing, but at the end of the day, we got our vehicle back. The community stepped up to help us through the gap, and we were able to continue to do what we do.
Good. Amazing. Mm-hmm. So for those individuals who are watching this show, yep, now, how what's the best way for them to support Feed the Need?
Yeah, the best way, find us online at feedtheneedindurham.ca. And give us a call at 905-571-3863. You can get to know us from our website and get to know what we're doing. And there's lots of things you can do. You can donate through the website. You can call us and host a food drive, collect food. And mostly, the main thing, just get the word out about what's going on in our community. That's the biggest thing. Just share what you're hearing today with people at work or at school or wherever you're going, just to help make sure that we understand what our neighbors are going through.
Yeah, and maybe when you're at the grocery store and you notice tuna's on sale, mm-hmm, salmon's on sale, peanut butter's on sale, grab an extra one and then deliver it to Feed the Need. Thank you so much,
Ben.
It was wonderful having you on the show. We'll be back with more on Oxbridge Scugog Life.
Think it's okay to drive high? Think again. Drug-impaired driving is as illegal as drunk driving, and in Ontario, the penalties are the same. If police suspect you're driving under the influence of drugs of any kind, or a combination of drugs and alcohol, and you fail a roadside test, your license will be suspended immediately for up to 30 days. You'll pay a penalty of $198. And you can be charged with a criminal offense of impaired driving, the same as alcohol. Driving high is never okay.
Hi there, I'm Mark Grice, the artist. Have you thought of taking up a new hobby? Maybe you want to start painting. Well, if you watch my show, you can learn how. I start out with a photograph like that, and I turn it into a painting like that, right here in my studio on Rogers TV.
Welcome back to Uxbridge Scugog Life. I have Big Red with me on the show, who is a professional bartender, and you're currently bartending at Chook
and Pickering.
Chook and Pickering.
Yes.
And it is a cool Mexican restaurant.
Yeah.
And the best margarita I have ever had.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah. So good. Lamore.
Lamora.
Lamora.
Yes.
Lamora.
Yeah, it's
so
like
good.
A blackberry chili margarita.
Yeah, so good.
It's good.
So today we're talking about some drinks that you can get locally.
Yes.
Maybe you're having it over the holidays. Maybe it's after holidays into the new year, but just some suggestions of some local drinks that we can get.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, this is pretty much, this is my Christmas list right here.
Your Christmas list.
Yeah,
okay.
So if anyone out there's looking for a gift to buy me, just it's all right here.
Yeah. Right here. So you're gonna pass this on through your social media to everyone you know.
Absolutely.
Then,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay. So the first one we're gonna go over is my favorite because I love ciders. I love beer, but I'm gluten-free.
Yes.
So cider is my go-to.
Yeah. So this is a good choice. We've got Two Blokes Cider, Two Blokes Hex Press Cider. They're just out in Port Perry. So it's nice local apples, locally made. It's nice, dry, it's crisp, it's refreshing.
Okay, I was gonna ask that, sweet or dry? Because
dry, yes.
When ciders are too sweet for me,
it's not great.
I don't like it too sweet.
I don't wanna throw anyone under the bus, but some of the big names are a little too sweet.
A little too sweet.
Yeah.
I like different flavors,
yes.
But you still don't have to go so sweet on them.
Yeah, this is a really good option.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So Two Blokes, where are we going from here?
Next to that is Second Wedge. So we've got three beers from Second Wedge. They're just local. They're over in Uxbridge. Unfortunately, the brewery's not open right now because they got hit pretty hard in that little hurricane that Uxbridge got.
Right.
So they're literally rebuilding from the ground up.
Yeah, they had the roof torn off,
yes.
A whole side wall torn off.
Yeah.
Do you have any idea if they're still brewing from there right now?
They're not brewing from there. So the craft beer community around here, amazing people. I was in the industry for years. Amazing people. And there's a lot of places that kind of offered up
a temporary spot.
Yeah,
for them.
A little tank for them. Say, okay, we can have these seven, but the eighth one's for you. You can do whatever you want.
Nice.
So yeah.
So good.
Yeah, everyone's been very helpful. So they've been still able to keep up with the demand and everything, which is nice.
Okay, so can you go right into their store to pick stuff up? You just can't sit in?
I don't believe so.
No? So, because I've still noticed their beer in around the restaurants within the community.
Yes.
And then they're also at grocery stores as well.
Yes, yeah.
So that's what they're doing right now.
Yeah. So they deliver all their beer and everything. So,
Okay. Yeah,
they can still do all that. But I'm pretty sure part of what happened was the roof caved in on the tap room.
Yeah.
So,
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay, so I'm glad that they're still at least brewing.
Yeah.
I've seen it at Zaire's, I've seen it at Vince's.
Yes,
and then
these three are available in the LCBO as well.
Okay,
yeah.
Beautiful.
So we've got the green one there right there, yeah, that's the high grass.
Okay.
That's honestly, it's one of my personal favorite beers. It's a lemongrass ginger saison. It's nice, refreshing. It's got that lemongrass taste to it that everybody loves. And
I find it's like you can have this beer all year round.
Yeah,
100%. It has that refreshingness to it. It's not too heavy, but it's light with a nice flavor to it.
Yeah. I think they started off doing it kind of like a seasonally thing.
Okay.
Just in the summer, but then it got too popular and now it's everywhere.
Okay.
And a little hint, what I like to do, pour it in a glass, muddle some jalapenos in there, and it's
Holy
a little spicy.
Jeez, that's awesome. Okay, what's this last one?
That's the Monday Night Piper, so that's a Scottish ale.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's on the darker side, so you get a lot of maltiness from it. It's not too hoppy, so there's no bitterness to it.
Okay.
But it's a nice dark option.
Okay, nice. Yeah, okay, let's talk about this.
All right, so these are some drinks from my friends over at the Durham Distillery. We've got the Wheat Kings Vodka and their Harvest Moon Whiskey. So the Wheat Kings Vodka is great, clean, crisp, refreshing. It's got almost like a sweet caramel aftertaste to it.
Nice.
And then $2 from every bottle is donated to the Gord Downie Foundation.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, and they do a strawberry gin as well, called Strawberry Fields, and $5 from every bottle goes to Durham College, who grows the strawberries that they use.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, just really quick, because I know we have others to cover,
yes.
But with the strawberry, you said gin?
Yes.
Strawberry gin?
Yes.
What drink would you make with the strawberry gin?
Actually, I used to work at Marwan's in Port Perry, at the Port Social.
Great restaurant.
Absolutely, yeah.
Great butter chicken.
Yes, the best you'll ever have.
Yeah.
And they make a drink specifically with that in it. I believe it's called the Lebanese Breeze.
Oh.
And I'm not going to tell you what's in it, but it's...
But you should go to Marwan's and
absolutely,
check it out.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Let's go on to the next brewery.
So that's Old Flame, a place that's near and dear to my heart. My good friend Jack Doak owns it. I worked there for several years. We've got three of their beers, the Red, the Brunette, and the Dirty Blonde. They're all fantastic. They've all won Best in Canada awards, and they're doing great over there.
Nice. They have a location in Port Perry, Newmarket, and now they're also in the Distillery District.
Yes, yeah, they just opened up a tap room in the Distillery District.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay. We have something very special at the end there from Brock Street.
All right, so I had to steal this from my fiance. She wouldn't let me have it, but I waited till she was asleep and I put it in my trunk. This is their premium vodka beverage case, which is an advent calendar with vodka soda in it.
That's
they
amazing.
Also do one with craft beer, and then they do a mixture where it's 12 vodka soda and 12 of their beers.
Amazing.
Yeah,
so what a great gift to give to someone right now, and you have some catching up to do.
Yeah. So they make their own vodka, and then they do their thing. I don't really know the distilling part of it, but they do their thing, and they get some vodka sodas out of it.
Amazing. Yeah,
again, all gluten-free, so.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much, Big Red. It was so great to have
Absolutely.
You on the show
Thanks,
again.
Thanks for having me.
We will have you back again.
Sounds good.
We'll be back with more on Uxbridge Scugog Life.
I'm Mallory, and I was walking home one night when an impaired driver hit me. He had been overserved in two bars before getting behind the wheel. If the servers would have called him a cab instead of serving him more alcohol, my life would be the same as what it used to be. I think servers play the biggest role in keeping us safe because it's up to them what state the person's in when they leave. Refusing service isn't personal, it's the law.
Welcome. Join me on the Rogers TV Durham for learning yoga in just 10 classes. My name is Sri. I'm a yoga teacher at Yoga Point, and it's my privilege to spend the next few weeks with you.
Knights of Columbus TV Bingo every Tuesday at 7 p.m. right here on Rogers TV with a guaranteed $5,000 grand prize jackpot on the full card winner. Every week, 7 p.m. Tuesdays, right here on Rogers TV.
Welcome back to Uxbridge Scugog Life. So when you're in the grocery stores, look for staples, not staples from a staple machine. Look for the staple items that you need to have in your own cupboards, because Feed the Need definitely needs support. So when you see things on sale, pick up an extra can. And when you have a chance, you can drop it off either with Feed the Need or at your local food bank. It is so needed. And I hope you got some great ideas for some drinks that you can keep within your home, give as gifts, and it's all local. Let's support local. So there's beautiful cideries around here. There's beautiful microbreweries, distilleries. So get out there and support local. Have a wonderful holiday season, everybody. We'll be back with more next week on Uxbridge Scugog Life.
The Rogers TV viewer response line. Email us or connect with us on social media.
Leonard Thompson, 13 years old, diabetes mellitus, 65 pounds.
Starve the child to let them live. The treatment's as cruel as the disease. It's a death sentence.
Dr. Banting,
this could be it.
He's the first to receive this trial.
But will it save him?
It's not pure enough.
So we try again. And again.